Dear ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to welcome you to today's lecture of the so-called Risk and Uncertainty series, which is conducted by the Center for Development Research here at the University of Bonn, by the United Nations University, as well as by the Bonn International Center for Conversion, the organization I belong to. Today, we are very pleased that we have Paul Walker here, and it's, I think, our second or third attempt to bring him here to Bonn. And for us, it's really a great pleasure to have you here to give a talk about From Ypres to Damascus, the quest to abolish chemical weapons. As you might know, Paul Walker received last year, he became a laureate of the Right Livelihood, the Right Livelihood laureate. He became what we call the Alternative Nobel Prize, and for his work on the abolishing of chemical weapons. We are very happy that you are here, and I think I hardly read any time such a very interesting CV than your ones. And I just will just pick out some of the stations of your life. Paul Walker, who was born in 1946, studied modern languages. He moreover studied also at Johns Hopkins University, at the MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and he was also at Harvard University, there at the Center for Science and International Affairs. And at that time, I found interesting, you already published a book, and I think this publish is still of high importance, and I think so far its goals are not reached. It's called, the book, title of the book was The Price of Defense. And it was about how U.S. politics could be much more preventive, much more diplomatic, and less military than it was at that time. And I think this is still a topic which still has to be discussed. Also to mention that what you told me before we met here, that you did military service here in Germany in the times of the Cold War, and that you worked for the intelligence, for the military intelligence at the interior German border. So you see that you got a mixed life and that you were also educated by the Jesuits, which brought somehow a completely different perspective into your life. And I think if you just see this different curve in your life, that you became really one of the most distinguished people who are really fighting for peace, and particular in the field of disarmament of mass chemical weapons of mass destruction. And I think there's one quote I learned, what you once were saying. You said, it is important for us all to recognize that during our short time on Mother Earth, we all must strive to leave this planet a more peaceful one, just and sustainable place for future generations to come. So the whole idea of sustainability and this in combination with peace, you always highlighted. Also to mention that you became director on environmental security and sustainability at the Green Cross International, that you were very often, one of your main endeavor was also to bridge the borders between different states, between different also so-called enemies. I think you were one of the first person who tried to bridge to bridge the gap between the Western and the Eastern world. That you, I think you particularly were able to establish the first context, particularly in respect to conversion with partners in the former Soviet Union, and then in Russia. And you are one of the persons who really started to initiate several efforts for abolishing of chemical weapons, near particularly the Chemical Weapons Convention Coalition is to mention. And today, in your today's talk, it becomes clear that on the one side, we still, and this was already covered by the media in the last week, it's an issue of chemical weapons, particularly with the very conflict in Syria, is still very high on the political agenda, and I really think there is a strong interest to learn from your side about the situation in Syria. And on the other side, with your title, you are also addressing this 100 years of World War I, the first time when in Ypres chemical weapons were used in military warfare. What also gives us an idea about this tragedy of more or less 100 years of use of chemical weapons in military warfare. So there are many reasons to mention. We are very happy that you're here. Just to mention also that we are very happy because here in this building is also the Right Livelihood campus here, one of the two ones we have here in Europe. And here's the headquarter. Recently, the headquarter moved from Uppsala here to Bonn, so we are very happy that you are here. And second to mention, if you got questions, I think Paul will talk for about 40 to 50 minutes, and we have can't cover all questions afterwards. We will have a reception outside with a glass of wine, beer, or water, whatever you like. And then you can also address the questions you couldn't ask or solve and discuss directly with Paul. Paul, we are very happy that you're here, and the floor is yours.
Really delighted to be here. I said to Jerry Sommer, who I met with earlier, Germany is sort of my zweite Heimat. You know, it's sort of my second country. I've studied here quite a bit and worked in Germany quite a bit. Ich kann auch ein bisschen Deutsch und ich werde auf Englisch sprechen. Aber wenn Sie zum Beispiel Fragen auf Deutsch stellen möchten, dann können Sie das machen. Und ich kann Deutsch ein bisschen verstanden sozusagen. Aber mein Englisch ist bestimmt ein bisschen fließiger als mein Deutsch. Ja. So, wenn es okay für alle ist, dann werde ich auf Englisch sprechen. I first came here as a high school exchange student a long time ago, back in the early 1960s, and I studied at a gymnasium in Saarbrücken, in Saarland. I second was a university student of the Uni Wien. So when I speak German, sometimes people will accuse me of having a Wiener accent a bit. And thirdly, I was here as a soldier, as you mentioned, back in still a long time ago, 40 years ago, over 40 years ago now, in a place called Helmstedt. And those of us who are my age remember Helmstedt, but some of the younger people here perhaps don't. But Helmstedt was the east-west German border crossing between East Germany and West Germany, on the way from West Germany to Berlin. And I was there, a very top secret outpost. I worked in civilian clothes and I worked in Russian. So my third language is actually Russian. And I've done a lot of work with Russian colleagues and Soviet colleagues since really the early to mid 1980s. But so first of all, let me thank all my colleagues and hosts here, as well the Right Livelihood College, which I'm glad to connect with here too, but BIC and ZEF, I guess you call it, and the United Nations University too, so who are all helping to host me in Germany. I was just in Hamburg. I spoke in Hamburg at the Institute for Friedensforschung und Sicherheitspolitik auf der Uni Hamburg last night. And then I go tomorrow to Freiburg, where there's a international conference for 3 days of environmental laureates. So it's actually very interesting. I'm looking forward to it because it will be a very interesting time with Golden Prize winners, Nobel laureates, Right Livelihood Award laureates, which I was very fortunate to receive in December, and many others from all over the world. So it will actually be a quite interesting conference. Most people I've never met before, so I'll enjoy that. And then I go to Berlin. I'll be speaking in Berlin on Monday, several times actually on Monday. So. Let me jump right into chemical weapons. How did I ever get involved in chemical weapons? That's what people always ask. In the 1980s, I worked here in Germany off and on with the Krefeld Initiative, the Göttinger Appell, and a variety of other efforts to protest nuclear weapons and the Reagan and Soviet policies back then. But that was primarily about nuclear weapons, Pershing ground launch cruise missiles, SS-20 missiles, things of that nature. So I've worked nuclear weapons a long time. I never paid much attention to chemical weapons at all until I, in the early 1990s, over 20 years ago, I got involved as policy director of the Armed Services Committee in the U.S. House of Representatives, sort of the Militärausschuss, you know, for our House of Representatives. And I had to deal with a wide variety of activities, you know, probably 100 different issues I had to deal with. But one of them was military base closure and cleanup, which actually is very, you know, much part of BIC and conversion. And I, an old friend of mine, Hebert Wolf, you know, was, I think, the first director of the Bonn International Center for Conversion. So I did a lot of work in conversion. But one of the things I realized back then in the early 90s was you can't really convert military bases unless they're clean, you know, unless they're greenfield, so to speak. Even if they're brownfield, so to speak, you can do something with them. But you know, most of the military bases I had to deal with, and there were over 500 U.S. military bases closed in the 1990s at the end of the Cold War in the United States alone, let alone Europe and Japan and everywhere else. Most of the military bases were not green-brown. They were black. I mean, they were really filthy, dirty, dangerous, toxic. And one of the toughest things to deal with them, still the case, is the existing stockpiles of weapons. And I didn't realize until I worked on the Armed Services Committee that at the end of the Cold War, the United States began downsizing. The Soviet Union, of course, began downsizing. All of NATO began downsizing, like demilitarization, if you want to call it that. But the United States alone has had to destroy about 100,000 tons of obsolete weapon systems per year since then. And how do we destroy these weapon systems? We rolled them all out into a big field in the middle of a military base, and we blew them up. And that had enormous environmental and public health impacts to it, long-term, you know, in the groundwater, in the soil, in the atmosphere, long-term sort of unspecified carcinogenic impact to local populations and communities. So one of the things I got involved in the Armed Services Committee was closure and cleanup of military bases. And when we were doing it in the United States, the Soviets also began in Russia doing it as well, and Eastern Europe, Ukrainians, the Belarusians, the Kazakhs, the Estonians, the Baltic nations. And one of the most interesting and tough issues was chemical weapons. You know, the United States and Russia had built up the world's largest stockpiles of chemical weapons, a big class of weapons of mass destruction. And I'll talk about some of the numbers here. But in July 1994, I did the first American on-site inspection of a Russian chemical weapons stockpile site. So I had an assistant secretary of defense, I had head of the army general, head of the U.S. chemical weapons program, Russian general, head of the Russian program, two congressmen from Alabama and another state, Arkansas, who had chemical weapons stockpiles in their states. And we all went to Siberia. And we entered into a military base. I'll show some pictures up here, a Russian military base. And at this base, they had 5,400 tons of nerve agent. A base called Shuchi that I'll put up on the board later. And we all came back from that visit astounded that the Russians had so much chemical weapons. Of course, the Americans had almost as much as well. And that they were all battlefield ready. And that there was almost no security on the site. And the site was right at the border of Kazakhstan, just above the Stans. And this was prior to Osama bin Laden and the rise of terrorism and all the rest. But we came back and we wrote a memo to the Secretary of Defense back then that said, we have to work with Russia and we have to get security on these sites for fear that some of these weapons would disappear and wind up, who knows where, Bonn, Hamburg, you know, London, Tel Aviv, Paris, you know, Washington, D.C. So that's how I get into it. I realized, in fact, much more so than I think most people do, that this was a really dangerous area that had enormously dangerous implications for global security and world terrorism and accidents as well. So let me jump into this. I'll talk for, is there a clock here? No? I use my watch. I'll talk for maybe 40 minutes and then open it up for questions and happy to discuss things. If there's something that's really unclear, a burning question you have in one of my slides, you know, just raise your hand and we'll interrupt the presentation here. So I always go back to World War One, and we're coming up on the anniversary this time next year, 1 year from now, 100th anniversary of the first major use of chemical weapons in warfare. This is actually a very famous picture of soldiers, Allied soldiers, in Ypres, Belgium, which is where the weapons we used. And they all have bandages over their eyes because you realized the chlorine that was used in the trench warfare back then, if it didn't kill you, it actually blinded you at least. And so a lot of the soldiers actually were not killed, but actually were badly blinded. And they had, you know, really a tough choice, either, you know, stay in the trenches and try to fight the heavy chlorine, which was coming in and heavier than air, so it fills the trenches, you know, this sort of yellow cloud that drifts with the wind, or jump out of the trench and get machine gunned, you know, and killed. So it was a very tough choice, but this is kind of a moving picture. And this is if any of you have been to Ypres, Belgium, what we call Flanders Field, that's Menin Gate, where every evening there is a very moving ceremony on all the victims of World War I, particularly in Flanders Fields in Belgium. And, you know, 90,000 in World War I were killed with chemical weapons. 1 million were injured. 190,000 tons of chemical agents were produced in the end by Germany, France, Britain, and the United States. But the first use was really the first major use. I mean, it's been used, you know, for centuries in various ways. But the first major use of this scale was, in fact, by Germany, when the Germans brought in not weapons, but actually gas tanks filled with, you know, compressed chlorine gas. 5,700 canisters. And one night when the wind was blowing the right way against the Allied forces, the Brits and the French and a variety of their colony representatives from North Africa and other places, they were opened up and the sort of chlorine drifted across and killed, you know, just thousands and thousands of troops. So, very moving, and there'll be next year, this time next year, there'll be major ceremonies here at Menin Gate and in the cemeteries of Ypres, Belgium. I would urge you to visit there if you never have. But because of the horrors of, you know, the warfare in World War I, and the use by all sides in the end, everyone took after the Germans then, you know, and built chemical weapons and used them as well. They basically banned chemical weapons in warfare. It was just too inhumane, too horrible, too indiscriminate. So the 1925 Geneva Protocol banned, you'll see under the second bullet here, the use of chemical and biological weapons, but not research, development, test, and evaluation. So the good thing was they banned them in warfare. The bad thing was countries could still research and develop them. So countries went forward, you know, particularly the Soviets and the Americans, and a lot of European countries too, and the Japanese, went forward, actually, and built enormous stockpiles. And they kept getting more deadly and more deadly and more deadly over time. Now, fortunately, they were really never used much, very slightly, but never used seriously in World War II because of the horrible nature of them. But you know, they have been used in a variety of different minor wars or regional wars since then. I could go back even further. There's a few other examples, but the major ones, probably the 1980s, when Iraq and Saddam Hussein killed thousands and thousands of Iranians in the 8-year Iran-Iraq war with chemical warfare agents. So, and there's still a question as to how he obtained these chemical warfare agents, as you know. And I think most of the West Europe, including Germany and the United States and the Canadians and others, will in fact finally be shown to have supplied Saddam Hussein with a lot of the precursor chemicals and technology that he used in that war. Saddam Hussein also attacked Halabja, the Kurdish village in North Iraq in 1988, killed 5,000 of his own citizens. And both the Kurds in Halabja and the Iranians now have big lobby groups against chemical warfare. So whenever we go to the Hague, where the Chemical Weapons Convention is situated, there were always large numbers of Kurds and Iranians who were, you know, very positively lobbying against chemical warfare. 91 Gulf War, Saddam Hussein had chemical weapons back then. he didn't use them in the war, but the Americans and Allied forces attacked Saddam Hussein's chemical weapons depots, blew them up, and after the war we realized, in fact, chemical vapor drifted downwind and hit everybody, hit innocent civilians, hit Allied troops, hit American soldiers. So a lot of the victims actually now, the long-term illnesses that have come out of the first Iraq Gulf War 23 years ago, are really the result of the Americans primarily hitting Iraqi chemical weapons depots. 1995, first really obvious use of chemical warfare by terrorist group, the Amchinrikyo. The Amchinrikyo had been trying for several years to use weapons of mass destruction. They didn't have access to fission material, to radioactive materials. They did try to build a biological weapon, and that didn't work out. There's a funny story that's told, kind of sad and funny, but where they had a big vat of botulinum toxin, which is a disease, and a biological weapon potentially. And the scientist doing it for them fell in the vat, actually. And he got out, and he was just fine. And they realized that, in fact, all their work at building a communicable disease, wasn't working out. So they went to the last option, which is chemical warfare. And they produced, actually, homemade sarin agent. But that was the bad news. The good news was they didn't know how to deploy it. So they actually put sarin agent, which is a liquid. Most chemical agents, they talk about gas, but these are usually liquid form, sometimes even frozen solid form, but typically liquid form. They put them in little plastic baggies, four of them, and they gave them to terrorists, the members of the group, and they went into four subway cars in Tokyo, four different ones, and they punctured the bag and just dropped it on the floor. And the liquid, see, it's a little bit like engine oil or maple syrup, if you will, and it spread out along the floors, and people stepped in it and splashed it and whatnot. And in the end, 12 people were killed, but 5,000 were injured, mostly in panic attacks from the, knowing something was going on. But if they had known how to disperse it properly as a gas or as a vapor, they could have killed thousands of people in the Tokyo subway. So fortunately, this was not a very successful attack. But Osama bin Laden, terrorist groups, continue to talk about obtaining weapons of mass destruction, nuclear, chemical, biological. And then we have Syria. We started to see the use of chemical warfare in Syria in December 2012 for the first time. And then about six or seven instances later, the major attack of August 21st last year happened, in which 1,400 civilians were killed in the middle of the night, 400 of those children in their beds in the eastern suburbs of Damascus. And that's, of course, what has launched all the public attention now, fortunately in some way, I think, to chemical warfare, particularly the chemical weapons in Syria and the Middle East. And I'll come back to Syria in a minute. So the good news is that we have a big, very successful chemical weapons convention, what we call the CWC. It was over 12 years of negotiation. It opened for signature in 1993, entered into force in 1997, had the sufficient number of ratifiers and member states. Russia and the U.S. both ratified in 1997. We worked strongly on building ratification. A two-thirds majority needed in the U.S. Congress and in the Russian Duma back in 1997. This was a big fight we were engaged in with the Clinton administration, working with the Clinton administration to get the final couple of votes. I can talk more about that later if you want. Very successful. Other than the United Nations, there's no treaty regime in arms control that has this number of states parties today. So 190 countries, only six countries outstanding. I'll mention those later. And eight countries have actually declared chemical weapons stockpiles that then burdens them with verified, inspected destruction. I'll talk about that a bit now. So who has chemical weapons? Or who had chemical weapons, anyway? Can you hear me in the back okay? If I don't, not using the microphone or anything, it's okay. The big one is Russia. 40,000 metric tons, it's a lot of weapons. Total, it's probably 7 or 8 million weapons in Russia in their stockpiles. The United States, also not small, 28,600 metric tons, 31,500 US tons. You always have to be careful which tons you're talking about here. India and South Korea, each about 1,000. That's still a secret number. The Indians and the South Koreans are particularly sensitive on that. I'm not quite sure why. But it's in the range of 1,000 tons, give or take probably 200 tons. Libya, 26 tons. Albania, 16 tons. Iraq, two big bunkers filled with only God knows, you know, definitely chemicals, but we're not quite sure what. And then Syria with about 1,335 tons, actually. And so the grand total of declared, this is just declared stockpiles now, is around, within, give or take, probably 500 tons. It's 72,500 tons. And these numbers change all the time as the countries go through and destroy their stockpiles and very accurately measure the weight. And also, these are kind of all rough figures. You can't assume they're absolutely, you know, perfect down to the gram or the ounce. So, the United States, I had to work all these issues when I was on the Armed Services Committee, and I realized, you know, after I left the committee and I went to work with Green Cross, they really needed public involvement, NGO involvement, and the like. So obviously, we worked very hard on this whole program since the mid-1990s now. The United States has 9 sites they declared. You'll notice that 8 of these are in the continental United States. This one, Johnson Atoll, is in the middle. So this is Hawaii. And this is the atoll, which is 750 miles west of Hawaii, about 1,000 kilometers, 1,200 kilometers west of Hawaii. So this is, you know, way out here somewhere. The only things I'll point out here, you know, these are widely dispersed, but the biggest one is Tooele, Utah, just west of Salt Lake City, 44%. So 44% is like, I think it was like 14,000 some odd tons in Tooele. The smallest one is Bluegrass, Kentucky, 2%. It's only about 470, when I say only, 475 tons. It's still an enormous amount. You know, this alone is about half the size of the Syrian stockpile alone. So the American stockpile is about 30 times the size of what, you know, Bashar al-Assad has declared. So you put it in context, the Syrian stockpile is actually relatively small compared to what the Russians and Americans were dealing with. And both the Russians and Americans had much larger stockpiles before the Chemical Weapons Convention was finalized, probably by a factor of 3 or 4 times, maybe more. And they all knew, Russians and Americans had been negotiating, Soviets and Americans had been negotiating the treaty and an agreement bilaterally between them since the early 1980s. And they were all very quietly dumping their weapons at sea, burying them, burning them in open stockpiles, things of that nature, to get it down to lower numbers. Because they realized once they came under the Chemical Weapons Convention burden of inspections and environmental constraints and the like, it would be a lot more expensive, a lot more time-consuming. So these stockpiles are really what was declared, you know, when the treaty entered into force in the early to mid-90s. The Russian stockpile, these are small signs. You probably can't read them back there, but Moscow is here. So most of Russia's stockpiles, 7 stockpiles, they're all pretty much the same size, give or take, you know, about 1,000 tons. The only one west of Moscow is Pocha, which is in the Bryansk Oblast. And the easternmost is Shucha. And this is the stockpile I visited here in 1994. 3-hour flight east of Moscow, 2-hour drive in from Chelyabinsk, out in no man's land. There's nothing there except villages, farming villages. The Ural Mountain Range is here. So Shuchi is pretty unique. It's the only one east of the Ural Mountain Range, if you know Russian geography. All the west are sort of in European Eurasian side of Russia. This is the border of Kazakhstan as well. So this stockpile is sitting right on the border of Kazakhstan, which made us even more worried. Shuchi, the far right one, and the one in the middle here, Kizhny, just east of Moscow, are both the ones that were always of most concern because they're the ones that have artillery shells. I'll show them in a minute. All the other ones are big bombs, spray tanks, you know, very difficult to move unless you have a truck and a front loader, you know, a bulldozer or something. But those two sites, Kizhny and Shuchi, are the ones each with over 5,000 tons, each with over 2 million artillery shells filled with nerve agent, and neither back in 1994 with almost any security on the sites. This is what it looked like when I went in 1994. You walk into above-ground buildings, corrugated metal and wooden warehouses, big barn doors on the front, swinging barn doors with bicycle padlocks, windows, broken windows, holes in the roof, grass a meter high, big fire danger, little chain link fence around the exterior with a little 16-year-old Russian army guard, unpaid in 6 months, standing at the front gate, and that was it. Really astounding, you know, what was there. Had a railroad running through it, battlefield ready, and this is what the weapons look like. So this is now fast forward to 2002. We obviously began to work a lot in Russia. Green Cross was invited in by the Russians and because of Gorbachev's. Gorbachev is our founder. Because of Gorbachev and also because the Americans realized that, and Westerners here in Western Europe too, realized they really needed neutral facilitators, people who would be trusted in Russia to try to process the dangerous construction and dangerous operations of these facilities. So what those two sites have, Shuchi and Kizner, were over 2 million of these artillery shells. These are all filled with about 5 kilograms of nerve agent, 5 different calibers, and then big missile warheads, Frog and Scud, short and medium range missile warheads filled with mini bombs, about 100 little mini cluster VX nerve agent weapons inside. And a kind of interesting story, this was 2002, where Green Cross had organized groundbreaking ceremony for the facility, which was to be built at this site. It was being built by the Americans, the Russians, the British, the Canadians, and a handful of other countries, too. The big ones were the Americans and the Russians, actually. And we had 250 press from all over the world here. And Jill Doherty, who's a well-known CNN reporter, got up. She's still on CNN, too. She got up and held one of these weapons in front of the camera live, and she said, and this is what we're talking about, the elimination, you know, safe elimination of 2 million artillery shells here, blah, blah, blah. And the, she said, this, of course, is a training weapon for Russian troops. And the commanding officer here came up and said to her, Ms. Doherty, you should know that we don't have training weapons. We gave up using these a long time ago. We don't train with them at all. And she said, well, isn't this a dummy weapon? He said, no. He said, this is a live weapon. And we suddenly realized that the weapons they had brought up 20 kilometers from the stockpile, up a Siberian road, so to speak, in the back of a pickup truck, were actually live weapons. So they brought in, I don't know, probably a couple of 100 kilograms of VX nerve agent into the middle of this 250 visiting press back in 2002. And that gave people, you know, a bit of a wake-up call. In the United States, we would never have, this stuff never moves out of the bunkers at all. But, this is Siberia. Russians thought nothing would happen. It's all safe and sound. So you can imagine if terrorists had come in or somebody had wanted to steal one of these things. So that gives you a sense of the challenges we were dealing with in working in Russia. So let's look at the United States, how far the countries have come now. The United States began destroying chemical weapons in 1990, and they had agreed to do this bilaterally and unilaterally with the Russians. Both countries, long before the Chemical Weapons Convention was open for signature, agreed just to give up the stuff. They said this is, has no military value, it's dangerous, it's leaking, it's too expensive, it impacts the local communities. We got to get rid of this stuff. So the Americans actually started building their first destruction plant in the mid-1980s. And they weren't quite sure how to destroy this stuff. These weapons were never built to be kind of dismantled and recycled. They were built to be used on the battlefield. And so when the 1980s came along, everyone said, well, how do we actually get rid of this stuff now? What's a good cost-efficient, safe way to do it? Well, the Americans proposed, the U.S. government proposed that we burn them all, but we burn them in the world's biggest incinerators. Sophisticated incineration, heavily scrubbed. Everyone felt it would be, the U.S. military felt it would be very safe. This is the incinerator that was built in Umatilla, Oregon, right next to a Native American the Matilla Tribe Reservation. So it gives you a sense, to some extent anyway, the massive nature of these. Each of these facilities costs $5 billion, milliarden dollar. The first one they built was actually on Johnson Atoll, which was the prototype of practice incinerator, so to speak. This is the really the third one to be built. So from 1990 to today, the United States has now destroyed 90% of its stockpile, 25,650 metric tons destroyed. Seven of the nine stockpiles are closed and being cleaned up and, you know, will be decommissioned and put to civilian use. There's been about $30 billion spent. Cost eventually will go over $40 billion. We have about a decade, almost a decade to go still. Two facilities under construction, one in Colorado, Pueblo, Colorado, and one in Kentucky, Bluegrass, Kentucky. So this has actually been a very successful program on the whole. I can talk more about the details. I'll get into some of the details a little bit later, too. But, you know, on the whole, it's actually gone extremely well, but taken much longer and a lot more money. So in Russia, you know, Russia started late, had no money in the 1990s. When we visited Russia in 1994, the Russians were desperate to get Western support, American support, German support, British, Canadian, any support they could. They finally got going and built their first facility, which began operating in December of 2002. So they were, you know, about 12 years behind the United States at that point. But to their credit, you know, they really have accomplished a lot between 2002 and today, 12 years now. They've destroyed more than the United States has, 30,400 tons. So if you average it per year, the Russians have destroyed per year almost double what the United States has. And that's primarily not because they've spent more money or they're better at it, but it's primarily because most of their weapons, like you see here, this is an aerial bomb at a place called Merdikovsky. Most of their weapons, might even be all of them, actually, have no rocket propellant and no explosives in them. And so it's a lot easier, actually. All you got to do is access the weapon. In this case, what they do is they open the bomb. Each of these bombs has about 500 kilograms of VX nerve agent inside it. And they suit up, like you see here, because you can't breathe in the fumes at all. They'll open the bomb, and then they pour in neutralant. They pour in hot water and sodium hydroxide, a caustic reagent. And they close the bomb up again, and they let it essentially cook for about, you know, it's exothermic. It releases heat and self, you know, reacts inside the bomb, cooks for about 3 months, then they go back in, roll it back out of the warehouse and check to see how much is destroyed, take measurements, and if it's really fully destroyed, if the VX nerve agent's gone, to six nines, 99.9999%, it's quite a bit, then they actually drain the bomb and wash out the bomb and treat the liquid agent in the second stage. So, to date, two stockpiles have been fully neutralized in first stage, destroyed in the first stage. It means they still have a lot of toxic effluent they have to deal with. About $8 billion spent in the United States, and they have, hard to know, but I would say probably 5 or 6 years to go to finish their destruction program. So this has likewise actually been a very successful program. We've had Green Cross outreach offices at every one of the Russian stockpile sites. Up until the last 3 or 4 years. And when the Russian sites began operating, you know, back in 2007, 8, 9, 10, they quietly told us, me and Green Cross, that they no longer needed public outreach, and they could manage everything just fine. So when operations began, ironically, we all had to leave to a large extent. We still have one office in what's called Izhevsk in the Udmurt Republic. Other countries, Albania, destroyed at 16 metric tons back in 2007. South Korea in 2008, although there's no information on the South Korean program at all. It's all top secret. India 2009, there's more information on the Indian program, but not much. Well, the Indians are also very sensitive. Libya, now in, I should have put a date up here, but just was last year, 2013, they finished their destruction. of the agent itself. Iraq declared in 2009, but Iraq has these two big bunkers the size of a soccer field, three stories high, filled with everything chemical weapons related to Saddam Hussein had. And those were all sealed up after the UN inspectors inspected it all back in the mid-1990s after the first Gulf War. So Iraq, in some ways, has chemical weapons, but in other ways really doesn't. These are all sealed bunkers. Nobody knows what's inside, except we know one of them has a big 2,000-pound unexploded American weapon in the middle of it. Because the United States hit both bunkers. They blew up part of one, and they dropped a laser-guided bomb in the roof of the other one, and it didn't blow up. So the challenge here, there's a lot of work going on right now to try to evaluate how you can get into the bunkers, estimate what's in there. There's, you know, sniffing, they're drilling holes and putting sniffing devices in, and they're putting, eventually they'll put robots in with cameras to try to see what's there, and nobody really wants to enter the one with the unexploded 2,000-pound bomb. You know. And Syria, of course, declared last September, and we'll talk about that more. The picture here is the Albanian stockpile. Those are canisters, I think about 50 kilograms each of mustard agent. And Albania joined the treaty, interestingly, in the 1990s as a non-possessor state. And then in 2002, I think it was, might have been 2003, they came to the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons, the implementing agency in The Hague, and said, oops, we think we found what looks to be a chemical weapons stockpile up in the mountains outside of Tirana. Could you come and check for us? So the OPCW sent inspectors, the Americans, the Germans, and the Swiss all sent experts in. And sure enough, it was a mustard agent stockpile in a little garage in the mountains, no security, you know, open doors. I mean, it was just, when we think back to then, it was like, thank God, none of this disappeared at all. At least we don't think it disappeared. So they identified a stockpile in 2003. Germany was very good. A company called the Eisenmann Corporation here, I don't know if any of you know it, in Germany, went in and actually built a mini incinerator and started to burn these weapons in 2007. And unfortunately, they miscalculated the heat that would be produced in each of these drums. And so one of those drums, the first one that went in, was estimated to take 19 minutes to burn. And the incinerator was designed with an afterburner and all to do that, which was fine. But instead it took 19 seconds. And it literally, it exploded basically in the incinerator when the heat rose. And got so hot that in fact burned a hole right to the bottom of the incinerator. So everything had to be shut down. Fortunately, no workers were killed. Then we had to find a welder to weld the furnace. And I didn't realize welders have to be licensed to weld furnaces, per se. They have to be trained to do furnace work. It took 6 weeks to do that. And by the time the welder got finished, Albania had technically violated the Chemical Weapons Convention because they had a deadline, the end of April 29th, 2007. And they had not asked for an extension, which they could have done. So Albania actually set the example in violating the treaty, completely unintentionally, you know, of course, due to a technical problem with the incinerator. But in fact, since then, of course, the Americans, the Russians, and the Libyans have all violated the treaty as well on deadlines. We can talk about that more. The other thing I'll just mention in passing, too, is buried chemical weapons. I'm talking really about stockpile and stockpile destruction, which is obviously the most dangerous material. You don't want it to be used. You don't want it used in Syria. You don't want it to be stolen out of Russian or American stockpiles or elsewhere. But we have enormous burial sites all over the world of chemical weapons. You know, up until the 1980s, the typical way to get rid of any weapon systems, let alone chemical, was to either dump them at sea or bury them. And anyone know what the right picture is? Probably not. This is actually downtown Washington, D.C. It's a very wealthy neighborhood in northwest Washington, D.C. called Spring Valley, right around American University, which is a big, you know, old university in Washington. And these are wonderful homes. A lot of congressmen, senators, and ambassadors live there. And in 1993, in the backyard, this is what, over 20 years ago now, in the backyard of the Korean ambassador's house, he was building a gazebo in the backyard. The backhoe went in and located a cache of weapons. So they called in the military. The military looked at it, evaluated it, and said, these are actually not only weapons, they're chemical weapons. And they went back and looked at the historical accounts from all the way back to World War I. It turned out American University was the first chemical weapons laboratory of the United States during World War I. And after the end of World War I, 1917, they closed the laboratory and they told them just to get rid of everything. So they dumped all their chemicals and their weapons and the rest all over Northwest Washington, D.C., without documenting it at all. And subsequently, between 1917 and today, a lot of homes built there. The university expanded, multi-million dollar homes were built. It's very fashionable, you know, as you say, a high rent district in Washington. And after 1993, they realized the Army had to go in and survey every single property in the neighborhood, over 1,000 private properties. And they've been doing that now for 20 years. And they found about 100 homes with chemical weapons in the front and backyards. They had to go in and dig up the yards, you know, cut down trees, rip up driveways, rip up stone walls, dig down, you know, 10 meters deep, on and on, just ruined like this. You can see bulldozers in people's backyards. And this is still going on, actually. So for 20 years, the Army has declared the whole area clean 4 times. And new weapons have been found again the next year. So it hasn't made for a lot of confidence in the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, so to speak. And the latest story here is that there was one big dump site, one big trench that was in the historical accounts called the Sergeant Maurer Pit. And nobody knew where that was. And they decided 2 years ago they had found it. But unfortunately, it was under the basement of the American University president's home. And the American University president's families for the last, the house was built in like 1960, I think, and beautiful, you know, brick home. And the families have been getting sick over the years with brain tumors and blood cancers and things. And the university itself moved the president's family out, I think about 10 or 12 years ago. That we're not going to use this house anymore until we figure out what's wrong with it. And they've now discovered, in fact, it's probably related to the buried chemical weapons under the basement. So when they built it, they must have just dug a hole, found the weapons, I'm sure, pushed everything deeper, poured concrete over it, and built the whole house up on top of it, not realizing, in fact, all of these agents vaporize over time and will seep right through concrete, come right up into the house. And so they've just, this year, ripped the whole house down. Totally demolished, and they're digging out the whole yard down about 10 meters deep to bedrock. And they found, they've had to shut down part of the neighborhood, I think 4 times now, finding chemical weapons in the yard under the basement of this house. So, and this is what some of them look like, you know, just typical old, rusted, corroded weapon. But we know in the United States there's a report that went out in the mid-1990s of about 250 suspected sites all over the United States. Russia refuses to talk about buried chemical weapons. Most other countries do, too. We know it exists everywhere, particularly here in Europe, too, where it's not necessarily burial sites, but it's actually World War I and World War II chemical weapons that were just, you know, fired and misfired and the like. So there are still a whole range of long-term challenges here when we talk about buried. And the other big challenge is sea dumping. Everybody dumped these things at sea. And this is 2 examples. There were barges full. These are all, you know, drums of chemical agent, and they just sunk the whole barge. And these are drums of chemical agent that just dropped off, you know, port and starboard and stern as they went out. And we have dump sites in the United States off the East Coast, Georgia's Bank fishing grounds. We have a big dump site around Hawaii off of Pearl Harbor, dump site off the West Coast of California. The Russians have them all over. You may have seen. One of the big concerns in the Sochi Olympic Games was 2 years ago, barrels of mustard agent washed up in the Black Sea beaches, out of the Black Sea. And the Russians, of course, didn't want anyone to even hear any of this. And, you know, this is a big, big issue now, particularly in the Mediterranean, talk about Syria a bit, and particularly in the Baltic. German Nazi weapons were dumped by all the Allied victors in World War II in the Baltic. And the Baltic is literally carpeted, littered with chemical weapons throughout much of it, which is a big issue in the dredging for the Nord Stream Russian-German pipeline a couple of years ago.
So let's talk about Syria a little bit to bring us up to the present.
So what are we doing in Syria? Syria's declared 1,335 metric tons, give or take a few tons probably, of mostly precursor chemicals, which means not agent per se, but of the recipe, the mix of chemicals. 23 tons of that, though, is live mustard agent. Mustard agent is old. It's old technology, so to speak, in chemical warfare. If you really want to kill efficiently, you build nerve agents. You produce nerve agents today, VX in particular. One drop in your skin will kill you in about 2 minutes. Any slightest little inhalation, you're dead. You're gone. Mustard agent, you can survive. It's a very ugly agent, but it does horrible things. It's a burn agent. If you hit with mustard, as we've seen many times in some of these cleanup programs, and fishermen in the Baltic too will bring up mustard agents in their fishing nets and splash it all over them. Your hand will blow up the size of a soccer ball. Be like this, just from the ugly burns, taking months to recover. 50% has been removed from Syria to date. I think it's up to like 53%. Wonderful step forward, really historic move. That's all been, when I say removed, it's been shipped to the port of Latakia and picked up by a Danish ship and a Norwegian ship, freighters, and moved into the Mediterranean. The remainder should be removed in April, but nobody knows. Russia said everything would be out by April 13th, which is what, 4 days from now? Is that Monday, I think, or Sunday or Monday? Or Tuesday? I don't think that's going to happen, actually. But we're hopeful that it could be a little bit later. Syria has said they think they can successfully move everything to the port by April 27th. So another 2.5 weeks. We'll see. I watch this very carefully, but I urge you all to also watch. And the agreement was, of course, everything gets destroyed this year. Everything was supposed to get destroyed in first stage by the end of June. But the Cape Ray, this is the American merchant ship, and this is a photo taken in Rota, Spain, where it's been docked now for 2 months. The big American and NATO naval base there. Everything on board the Cape Ray was supposed to be destroyed by the end of June. But the processing on board the Cape Ray will take probably 2 to 3 months. So you can think if the chemicals don't come out of Syria by the end of April, May, June, just gives you 2 months at the most, probably not going to happen. So we've missed the first deadline. Everything was supposed to be removed from Syria by February 5th. That was the formal agreement. Of course, it hasn't happened. But if it gets out, by the end of May, the end of April, middle of May, it'll be, February, March, it'll be two and a half months late. But as far as I'm concerned, as long as we get it all out of Syria, it's just a really remarkable step forward. So let's look a little more closely at what all this is and what's going to happen to it. The picture on the right is the field deployable hydrolysis system, FDHS they call it, in military terminology. It's basically a big plumbing machine. It's got a lot of valves and tubes here that bring in the liquid agent, mustard agent, or whatever else, whatever the chemical we're dealing with. Pumps everything into the tank here. This is a big, mixing tank, and a big stirrer inside. And they pump in hot water and sodium hydroxide, and there's careful recipes for every single agent, so you can't say for certain what the mixture is, but it's a very caustic agent, and that basically destroys the chemical as it could be used as a weapon. So once it comes out of here, after 2 hours of mixing, it's pumped into other holding tanks. And then what you have is you have 10 to 15 times the volume of the original amount, but still very toxic. It's a little bit like drain cleaner or Drano. I don't know if you have Drano here in Germany, but clean your plumbing or unplug your toilet or something. your bathtub. So that still has to be treated in a second stage. There are two of these units on board the ship. There's a third unit which has been cannibalized for spare parts. All of this comes from Aberdeen, Maryland, which is the headquarters of the what's called ECDC, the Edgewood Chemical and Biological Defense, the Research and Development Program for Chemical and Biological Defense issues in the United States. And it's deployed just like this on board the ship. It's on a deck in a big tent, and it's also self-contained. So if there's any leakage, you know, there's always leakage and drips a little bit here and there. It's all contained within the tent, and it's also contained atmospherically, so that it in fact contains all solid, liquid, and gaseous effluents. But nothing will go in the Mediterranean unless the ship sinks, you know, which is the worst case, I suppose. Unlikely, but you never know. And everything is really self-contained. And to a large extent, you can operate without a mask on. You know, they'll, I'm sure, test the air all the time. And there'll be maybe sometimes where they have to be suited up in a moon suit. But for the most part, you can see the guys here working, I think, with just a little face mask on. So what happens to all this? So 560 metric tons of the 1,335 tons that have been declared will be put on the Cape Ray, the ship, and hydrolyzed, as you see here. All of that is being moved out of Syria on the Danish ship. The Danes are actually moving it out, and then they will meet with the Cape Ray, the American ship from Rota, Spain, in the southwestern Italian port of Gioia Tauro. And everything will be transferred in these big ship containers from the Danish ship to the American ship. The question is always asked, why aren't the Americans picking up the chemicals in Syria? It's because the Syrians don't allow the American ships in their territorial waters. So the Danes and the Norwegians have been very good. The challenge for the Danes and Norwegians is that their time frame at first was going to be like 30 days. Pick up, you know, these ships in the bed. Well, it's been like 90 days now, and it's still going on longer. So the original budgets for Denmark and Norway have gone up by like a factor of 50, I think. It's about 100,000 euros per day for the ship. So you can imagine if you're planning on 30 days and you wind up with 120 days of effort, it gets expensive after a while. Let's see. There are 154 tons of one precursor chemical, which is powdered, the only chemical that's not liquid, which is going to go to the United Kingdom, to Britain, and that'll be burned in an incinerator in a place called Ellesmere, England, and that'll be on the Norwegian ship, I believe. So it'll be delivered by the Norwegians to Britain. 122 metric tons of isopropanol, which is basically alcohol, you know, based, dilutes very easily with water. The Syrians are destroying it themselves in Syria, and that's all verified by the OP study. 500 metric tons will be treated of precursor chemicals that come on the Norwegian ship will be treated directly in the United States in an incinerator in Port Arthur, Texas, and in Finland. I'm not quite sure what the Finnish company called EcoChem, and I think it's not incineration. I'm not quite sure what that treatment may be. And all of the toxic waste, which will be somewhere in the neighborhood of 6,000 tons, that also is being stored on the second deck of the Cape Ray, you know, it's an enormous amount of toxic liquid, is going to be delivered by the Cape Ray to the United States, to Texas, to Finland, and to Germany. And I was at the German facility yesterday that some of you may know. It's a facility called GEKA, G-E-K-A. AKR, which is in Munster, Germany. And they have three treatment plants there. They have an incinerator, which is the oldest. They have a plasma reactor. If you know what that is, I can talk about that a bit if you want. It's a very high temperature, unique electric-fed reactor. And then they have a Swedish Dynasafe electric furnace as well. And as far as I know, what they explained to me is that they'll have about 370 metric tons being of liquid waste from the Cape Ray being shipped into Bremerhaven, and then that will move by truck. You know, it's pretty high toxic waste at that point. It's not live agent, but it's not a weapon anymore. But you don't want to spill it on the side of the road, you know, or have an automobile accident with it. That'll be shipped to Munster, and then will be burned probably over 2 or 3 months in the incinerator at Munster.
So I'm going to do a few final slides. I think I have like 10 more slides I'm going to go through very quickly, and then we can stop. And I'm sure you have loads of questions probably and comments you want to make. Let me just explain. All of this probably has sound, you know, somewhat easy. Like we're successful 20 years, we're getting rid of all this stuff. But really, if you're in the middle of it like I am all the time, this has been a pretty difficult, contentious process. One of the issues is really cost. Nobody ever dreamed it would be so expensive as it is. I mean, the original U.S. estimated cost was $2 billion. Still a lot of money. But what did I say the expense is today? Close to $40 billion, 20 times the original estimated cost. So cost has just gone through the roof on all sides. The Russians first, you know, when I talked to them in 2002, they said, oh, $3 to $4 billion, you know, maybe even less. Here. Now it's going to be well over $10 billion. I predicted that actually 10, 12 years ago. It's going to be $10 billion or more. Now, about a third of that paid for by the West. The two big countries who've really helped the Russians enormously have been the United States. The U.S. Has committed over $1 billion to the Russian program, and Germany. Germany has committed, most of you probably know this, at three sites, Gorny, Mbaka and Pochep have committed probably over 600 million euros now. And they've essentially built those three sites for the Russians. And they've learned good lessons at each one. The first site was like, oh yeah. But Gorny was just a prototype site. And the mistake the Germans made, it was the Eisenmann Corporation again that worked in Albania. The mistake the Germans made first is they built the facility. These are big neutralization plants. The Russians are not using incineration. Neutralization plants, just like on the Cape Ray, only big. And the Germans built it, designed it, built it, tested it with simulant here in Germany, dismantled it, moved it to Russia, and had the Russians rebuild it. And that was the mistake. And they learned at the second site, Kambaka, which was a much bigger facility, bring the German workers in and have the Germans build it, and then train, and then the Russians will operate it. It's their responsibility. But Gorny was pretty shaky for the first couple of years, having been built by the Russians. Technology choice. Incineration, if you know, in the environmental and public health communities is very controversial. Everyone is suspicious, myself included, about what's coming out of the smokestack. The difficulty with the good news on incineration, you throw anything in the furnace, burn it. As a bumper sticker says, build it, burn it, forget it. The downside is once everything goes into the furnace, that's it. You can't control it. It's gone. And it all almost goes up as a gas. There's thousands of tons of gaseous emissions every day from these incinerators. The thermal engineers will tell you that they design them to work very cleanly, burn everything, heavily scrubbed. You have dry scrubbing, wet scrubbing. You have carbon filters at the end, which try to take out the heavy metals like mercury, which we find in the weapons. And the real proponents of incineration will say, I'd rather be sitting right at the top of the smokestack and take a deep breath of that good smokestack air. You know, it's cleaner than the air you breathe outside here in my garden. And I don't personally really believe that. But there's been big fights all along over what the most appropriate safest technology is, the most cost efficient. Emergency preparedness. If you had someone say, to your surprise, there were 5,000 tons of VX nerve agent, you know, somewhere here in Bonn, and the German government was going to build a big incinerator and burn it in your backyard, you'd be a little concerned, right? Well, communities here have been very concerned. And so there's been enormous efforts in emergency preparedness. What do you do in a worst case? Unlikely to happen, but you know, you should be prepared if it does. So in the United States, for example, every school, and there have been many schools, dozens of them, within, say, 5, 6, 8 kilometers downwind of these plants, every school has been overpressurized,
with their own air conditioning system, has been applied with sufficient water, cots, food for a week for students and faculty, and been remodeled with bulletproof glass in all the windows and doors, so you can keep the children and the teachers inside, and keep the families outside. Because the first thing, of course, as parents, all of us would do is go to school and pick up your kids, you know, and you don't want to do that in a case like this. Investment, community investment and involvement. This has been a big issue, particularly in Russia, but also in the United States. The remote communities where these chemical weapons stockpiles are, and we've worked at them all, are very poor, very third world. I mean, I don't know how many of you have been to Russia, you know, the last 20 years, but if you get outside more than 20 kilometers outside of St. Petersburg and Moscow, this is more or less what Russia looks like. This is actually the main road in Shuchi, in the Siberian site I visited. And if you're a resident here, there are 40,000 residents in 14 villages here in Siberia at this one site. And you see, you know, $2 billion of American and German and other money coming in to your community to build a big new industrial facility. You want to have some, you know, windfall for your own community. So there's been negotiations with Russian communities, which we've helped facilitate a lot. We try to empower these communities. And roads have been built, sewage systems have been built, water systems have been built. This community actually had very little water. They had two big wells at each end of the village of Shuchi. And people would steal the metal pump handles all the time. There was typically no running water in the homes. Some of them did have running water. But when the British came in and actually built a whole new water main for the facility, which was 20 kilometers away, they put a new water main up and they hooked the village access lines into that. When they turned the water on, the pressure was so strong that, in fact, all the old corroded water pipes in these villages blew up and flooded the villages. And so nobody had water, actually, for 5 years after that. And a lot of issues like that about making a windfall. This is actually a first public hearing we held, by the way. We organized a public hearing, our first one in 1996 in Russia. And that's in the Dom Kulturi, the House of Culture. And the Russian military had said to us, nobody will turn out, you know, nobody's interested in this. Well, we had 1,000 people turn out. We filled the town square. We had to broadcast the hearings into the town square, and we had to literally work with the Russian military very carefully for several years before they would be comfortable speaking in public about these former top secret, you know, chemical weapons depots. So we've really helped to empower, I think, these communities and help to support them as well. This is the town square of Shuchi with the main church there.
In 92 or now?
This is actually 1994. I took this picture this is actually at the hearing, so this is 1996. But it's better now. It's actually, most of the streets have now been paved by the Russians, and we've tried to help the community quite a bit too. But you also, you know, realize that unless there's good transparency in what's going on, people are going to be suspicious. We all are. You know, we're dealing now with a lot of lack of transparency on the Syrian project. And I'm trying to work with the American officials and the United Nations officials and all to build more transparency, but there's been very little transparency around the Syrian issue. This is actually in downtown Shuchi. Those of you who read Russian, you know, will say without a guarantee of social support and protection for the community, there'll be no construction of a facility. And this is actually a protest in Texas, in Port Arthur, Texas. No VX, as in VX Innovation. No VX in TX, Texas. And that's where some of the Syrian chemicals are actually going. It's a big industrial toxic waste incinerator, unfortunately in the middle of a very poor black community. And so we Green Cross, had opposed shipping any of this material to Port Arthur, Texas. And most of the communities we deal with have said, the stockpile has been our responsibility. We'll take the responsibility for destroying it. So most of the destruction actually has been on site in the local community.
But the U.S. military has shipped some stuff to Texas and will continue to with Syria.
So we'll see. Without enough transparency, I think there will be protests. And last weekend, 10,000 people turned out in Crete protesting the destruction of the Syrian weapons in the Mediterranean, very concerned over what would happen with all this toxic waste in the Mediterranean, the tourism industry, the fishing industry, and a lot of it's just due to lack of knowledge. I think the destruction will go just fine in the long run, assuming all the chemicals can be taken out of Syria. And that's a bit of a challenge I can talk about more if you'd like. But, you know, a lot of these people have been saying the Americans and the Cape Verde ship are just going to dump everything in the Mediterranean. It's not the case at all. It's obviously illegal. It's not allowed. That's not the plan. But this is a great example of why you need public outreach, stakeholder involvement, and transparency in your process so that people feel like things are going well and know much better how they're going. One quick picture, that's our little outreach office in Shuchi in the Siberian site. A little green behind the green door, as we say, next to the grocery store, next door. And it's right in the town square. The woman on the right was our office director, and the woman on the left was our public relations director in Moscow. And this is some of the typical outreach we did in Russia and continue to do. You recognize the guy on the left there. We adopted one of the local orphanages. None of the foreign donors, Germans, Americans, Canadians, anybody would spend any money on the community. And that's been one of the fights we've fought all along. Is that they always define their investment as inside the fence and not outside the fence. And the fence was right around the facility. So Germany was very strong on this, by the way, and I've had many meetings in Berlin at the foreign ministry about this. That if it's equipment, the Eisenmann Corporation going in, building a big, nice industrial facility, that's fine. But if it deals with anything beyond that, it's not our responsibility, Russians can take care of their own people. We're not in the economic development field in this. So, and the Americans have been the same, most everyone has. So we've had to really work with communities and do things like adopt the local orphanage, which is extremely poor, and go out to the local farming community. This is Galina, the director of our office, there speaking in one of her seminars in the fields. So conclusions, and then I'll stop. You're probably tired of hearing me talk at this point, right? Chemical agents are no longer viable military weapons, definitely. They've become taboo. You can see this in the Syrian case. Nobody's going to use this anymore except terrorists or someone really crazy. All possessor states must complete safe elimination. So you still have, Russia. Russia still has 10 times the volume that Syria does. The Americans have 3 times the volume of the Syrians. So the Iraqis, we don't know, but we're going to have to do a lot of work on that. It's going to be very expensive. All non-member states must join the Chemical Weapons Convention. And, of course, those member states today are Angola, Egypt, Israel, Myanmar, former Burma, North Korea, and South Sudan. These are not easy, believe me. As we say, this is not low-hanging fruit. This is mostly high-hanging fruit. But we're working on these four on the top. North Korea, there's no communication with. We can't get any response from them. South Sudan, there's really no government to talk to. But these four, Israel has actually signed the Chemical Weapons Convention, not ratified. Myanmar has signed too, but not ratified. And I think it's inevitable next couple of years, at least those four will join. Protection of the environment, public health, worker safety, weapons demilitarization is an absolute necessity, trumping deadlines and budget limits. So you'll find some people over the years who've said, we've got to meet the deadline in the Chemical Weapons Convention. And I've saved you from talking about all the deadlines. It gets into all the fine print in the Chemical Weapons Convention. But my philosophy has always been, we want to get these destroyed. It's a big step forward in public health, environmental protection, sustainability, not to mention arms control and disarmament. But you don't want to do it if anyone gets hurt. We're doing this to save people and help the environment and save the earth. We're not doing it to kill people in the meantime. So I've really felt deadlines are important, but really are not going to take precedence over protection of public health. Transparency, stakeholder involvement, public dialogue is all sort of
very civil society, some democratic processing, you know, oriented. Doesn't go over big in some countries. You know, the Russians, we had a very hard time moving all this forward in Russia. We frankly had a hard time moving this forward in the United States as well in the early years. The United States finally built local outreach offices and public campaigns. The Indians didn't tell anybody. The Indians processed, burned all their mustard agent. Didn't say boo to the public, right in the backyard of a lot of people. And abolition of the whole class of weapons of mass destruction is really a historic achievement. So we shouldn't really overlook that. Final slide. A couple of inspectors coming back from Syria. This is the director general, who's a Turkish ambassador, Ahmet Uzuncu, in The Hague at the Organization for the Prohibition of Chemical Weapons. This is the group that won the Nobel Peace Prize. We work very closely with and continue to for years. And you'll recognize this guy. I think that this is the ambassador, Director General Ahmet Uzuncu. He's a very capable guy from Turkey. And this is the Nobel Declaration and the Nobel Prize here. And this was, of course, just a week after I had been awarded the Right Livelihood Award in Stockholm. So they were really very generous to invite me to Oslo. So I got to not only celebrate in Stockholm with all of our Swedish colleagues and friends in the Right Livelihood Award Foundation, but also to go to the Nobel Peace Prize ceremony. It's kind of a once-in-a-lifetime experience. And I will stop there.
Paul, thank you very much for the fascinating talk. And I think it became very clear that chemical weapons are just not only weapons, but they've got a huge impact on environment, on society.
Absolutely.
It's a very complex field to discuss, and I'm glad that you're here, and I'm sure that there will be some questions from the audience about this, I think, very pressing topic.
Everyone understands everything, right? It's been very complicated, believe me. Complicated and content, as we say in English, contentious. I don't know what that would be in German. Very, very difficult process with a lot of money, a lot of people involved. I mean, there have been thousands of people involved in this, obviously, all over the world. And I must say the Germans, given that I'm here in Germany, the Germans, other than not supporting the community investment that I've mentioned, the Germans have actually been very, very generous and good. They and the United States have been the big investors. The British have done well. The Canadians have invested a lot. All the Scandinavians, Swedes, Norwegians, Finns, the Danes, the Dutch, Japanese, the Australians, New Zealanders. There have been a few countries that haven't really pitched in very much. I've mentioned France, Italy. The nice thing Germany did was, the Russians wanted all the West global partners to kind of pick up each one of their sites and build them for them. And in the end, the Russians actually have spent two-thirds of the money, so it's only got about a third. But the site called Poche, I showed you earlier, in the Bryansk Oblast, was to be built by the Italians. And the Italians pledged 400 million euros to do that. Never came through. And what Germany did in the end was Germany actually built Poche. So Germany came in probably, it was 5-6 years ago, and said, okay, we didn't plan this, but it's important, we'll do it.
Yes, sir. First.
What will happen with all the chemical weapons dumped to the sea after World War I, for example? Because I got to know that close to the Flensburger Förde, for example, very close to the border, a lot of material dumped. Will it be diluted to the ocean? And what are the consequences?
Yeah, do people hear the question? Okay, he said, what will happen eventually with the sea dumped chemical weapons? No one has wanted to. Should I use the mic? It says it's on,
but doesn't seem to be. Oh, maybe a little bit. If I kiss it, it'll. If I bite it, it'll work. No one has really, up until the last few years, say the last 5 years, wanted to really talk about sea-dumped chemical weapons, because the priority, understandably, has been on safe and timely destruction of stockpiles. The big worry here is that these stockpiles might be used sometime They might explode, have major accidents. They could be stolen, diverted, particularly from Russia. Or, you know, in the Albanian case, small stockpile up in, you know, the mountains that no one ever knew about. If terrorists had known that, they could have done quite a bit of damage stealing the Albanian Chinese-produced mustard. More and more, fishermen are getting injured with chemical weapons coming up in the fishing nets. There was a boat that was quarantined, a clam dredger off the coast of New England, out of New Bedford, Massachusetts, 2 years ago. And they had to condemn the whole fishing catch, and they had to evacuate the whole crew who had been injured by mustard agent. There have been about a dozen fishermen killed in the Baltic. That doesn't get much news, but over the years, the last 20 years, by weapons coming up in their fishing nets. And so I think also with the growing investment in oil and in gas drilling offshore, and with the growing investment in windmills, offshore wind farms, people have realized we have to deal with this. It was raised quite a bit during the Nord Stream pipeline. Do you all know the Nord Stream pipeline, you know, the big Russian-German pipeline that was built through the Baltic? We raised the issue very early on. This is probably 8 or 9 years ago, with the Russians, that if they were going to dredge, the pipeline itself, you know, went down 2 meters in the bottom of the Baltic. And we realized that if they were dredging like that, they would probably dredge up chemical weapons. And so they had to do, we demanded actually a survey be done of weapons dumping in the Baltic so that in fact they could divert the pipeline around the, and if you look at the map of the pipeline that was built, completed, what, about two years ago, it zigzags like a snake all through the Baltic. It doesn't just go straight because, in fact, the Baltic's filled with weapon systems, you know, weapons dump sites, a lot of it chemical. And they did wind up, there's a report that you could get actually showing the number of weapons that they found. Unfortunately, what they did is whenever they found a weapon, they would raise it, you know, so they could dredge for the pipe. And then they would detonate it underwater. And that's what we call dilution is the solution. So they would blow it up underwater. They didn't want to bring it up because then that brings in all sorts of regulations and more expensive destruction programs and the like. So they blew up all the weapons they found. There were like 35 or 40 of them, I think, underwater. And the weapons we know, depending on the depth, depending on the salinity of the ocean, depending on the temperature of the ocean, cold, warm, are all corroding and leaking. And it's a big, I think, unknown question as to whether you should raise some of them. And I would never bring them ashore, but if you actually were to raise, for example, the shallow ones in the Baltic are all like 100 meters or so deep. Some of them are down, you know, like the Malaysian plain, down, you know, 5,000 meters or something. But the ones that are really shallow and get pulled up in fishermen's nets, I think in the end will probably be raised in some fashion. And destroyed in a destruction system on a barge at sea. But I think in the meantime, you know, we have to educate fishermen in particular. I know that's been done in some of the Baltic countries here. It's not really been done in the United States at all. The Russians, you know, refuse to admit that there's any sea dumping off their coasts. There's also been lake dumping, by the way. So there's actually some of this in lakes. We have some of this actually in the Great Lakes of the United States. I would guess there's some in lakes here in Europe. Italy has actually, this isn't generally publicly known, but Italy has raised something like 50,000 old chemical weapons out of the Mediterranean so far. And they don't have the money to destroy them, so they're actually stockpiling them in Civitavecchia, if you know Civitavecchia, which is a tourist resort west of Rome. And we're all very concerned over these old, aging, leaking, you know, weapons in Italy that I hope the Italians can get on and destroy in the near future. But I think there'll be some combination, to answer your question, you know, of letting them lie in the deep waters because it's just too expensive and impractical to raise them, cleaning them up in the shallower waters. We're doing some work right now in Green Cross trying to evaluate a former U.S. naval bombing range, which also fired depleted uranium weapons and chemical weapons, along with NATO naval forces, off the island of Vieques, which is just east of Puerto Rico. And the reason we're doing that, the bombing range was shut down 10 years ago. But there were 60 years of NATO naval bombing on one-third of the island. And there was a big naval base on the west end of the island with burn sites and dump sites. And there are 10,000 American citizens living in the middle of the island. And these 10,000 Puerto Ricans have cancer rates that are five times the rate of the same population on the main island of Puerto Rico. And so we're now looking at, we're doing a what's called a munitions registry. We're actually in the National Archives in Washington researching everything that was fired by all forces. It was mostly West European. Germans, I'm sure, were amongst them. And to determine what are the toxic contaminants. And those are all over the island and all over the waters as well, including a couple of chemical weapon dump sites in the Caribbean as well. So for reasons of public health and the environment and better understanding the food chain out of the water, how does this enter into the fish or plankton, and how does that work its way up the food chain and perhaps get into our bodies and impact our cancer rates? We'll have to know a lot more. But frankly, this is all new. You know, people have not wanted to talk about this at all. And we were very active in working with the Lithuanian government and the Polish government back in 2010 at the United Nations. And if you read back, there's a December 2010 United Nations General Assembly resolution about the importance of cleaning up the oceans and better understanding chemical weapons dumping in the oceans. And that was there was an update on that in December 2013 as well. Hasn't gotten much attention, but you know, in the long run, will be very important. Yeah, you had
a question in the back.
I'll let.
Yeah.
I just want to ask if there are links between the groups working against this toxic, what to do with this waste, and the anti-atomic movement. I think it's the same problem. What to do with the poison?
Right.
If you can just collect some questions with Solveig, Kerker.
You mentioned that I wanted to ask, what do you know of any university institution? Is research going on the impact of the leaking, probably leaking of chemical weapons in the sea?
In the sea.
Is there any official, or is there an intentional, because you said it's quite a new thing coming up, is there any research about this problem of chemicals getting into the food chain? And then the other question, I mean, we are talking about chemical weapons, we were talking about atomic waste, but we also have this field of biological weapons, which is also as dangerous, I think, from my point of view, as chemical weapons. So what is, do you know what is going on in that area?
Yeah, I let me take these first. In general, when you get into this field, as I've been for a number of years now, you realize that the legacies of the warring 20th century, you know, you know this well in your unexploded ordnance, old bombs, you know, excavated all the time. The legacies of the World War I and World War II world wars will stay with us for centuries, probably centuries to come. And we're still paying enormous price for the wars of the last century. And so I think it's a very good example of long-term environmental and public health impacts, whether it's at sea, whether it's in lakes, whether it's in Washington, D.C. backyards, you know, whether it's having to pay for, you know, the Munster facility, you know, destroying weapons in Munster every single day they find here in Europe. Just goes on and on. The groups working on it, there aren't many NGOs or groups working on this. It's usually governments. They've got, you know, I'm sure here in Germany, it's your defense ministries, it's your environmental ministries, and your public health ministries. We have something called the CWC Coalition, the Chemical Weapons Convention Coalition, which we founded in 2009 to provide support for everybody trying to destroy chemical weapons, abolish chemical weapons, strengthen the Chemical Weapons Convention, bring in the countries that aren't signed on board, and work on cleanup. But frankly, Green Cross, I think, is the most, in our program, is really the most prominent, has been, you know, for the last 15 years, most prominent program internationally. One of the challenges is no foundations are funding work in chemical, almost none, chemical, biological security issues and cleanup. So environmental foundations are not funding weapons cleanup, and arms control, disarmament, sort of global security foundations are not funding weapons cleanup either, because one side sees it as environmental, the other side sees it as arms control. So that's an ongoing challenge, trying to raise money to just do this work. Your first question was on chemical weapons in the sea and who's researching that. There isn't much. The only research that's really gone on has been Helsinki commission looking at the Baltic, and this came about. It's a multinational commission of all the Baltic nations, the Lithuanians, the Poles, I think the Dutch may be in it too, and the Finns have been, you know, were sort of catalyzed by the Nord Stream pipeline. And they realized all of this stuff is at the bottom of the Baltic. It's relatively shallow water compared to the rest of the world's oceans. And particularly what we're hearing on, you know, the news today around the Indian Ocean, which is, you know, much deeper, and that we don't really understand what's going on. I think there's some ongoing studies that are mostly funded now by the Poles and the Lithuanians. We've had some limited studies around Hawaii funded by the U.S. government, but nobody is anxious to dredge up. Most of the studies have actually been surveys to see where dump sites really are. None of these dump sites seem to be where they were documented to be. And yeah. There was a Center for Disease Control, the American group, study on Vieques, the island I just mentioned off of Puerto Rico. And they came up saying they didn't think there was any correlation between the bombing range and these very odd public health disease rates on the island. We don't accept that as the final word. And we're in negotiations with the Centers for Disease Control now to see whether we could work with them as, you know, legitimate neutral party, to see if we could go back and redo. We're doing the munitions study, which an NGO shouldn't be doing. This should be done by a government. It's expensive, and we're committing a lot of our own money to do this. And after that, we're actually doing a food intake study. One of the issues, for example, I don't need to get into all the specifics on this, but to give you an example, the U.S. citizens, the Puerto Ricans on Vieques, think that they're impacted by this toxic material, but they don't know what it is, where it is, where it's coming from. The CDC study that was done assumed certain food intakes, traditional for Americans, and I think for fish that was like 3 ounces per week. And yet we know the Viecans eat fish at every meal every day. So they eat probably at least 10 times that amount of fish. And so that seemed to me an obvious bias in the study, that if you're assuming that, their intake is much higher as far as fish is concerned. But it could also be land-based, because they raise chickens and goats and sheep and things on the island as well. And there's so much contamination from the ordnance that was fired on the island that it could actually be coming up through the soil and in meats and fruits or vegetables as well. And then on biological weapons, we do work in biological security as well. To the best of our knowledge, there are no biological weapons left at all, except little laboratory samples, particularly in the United States and Russia today. But there's still enormous issues around potential use of disease as a biological weapon. And the biggest challenge, I think, one of the biggest, is that the whole reporting system on disease. You've heard in the news lately that there was an outbreak of Ebola virus in Africa. How does that get reported? Mostly by newspapers. So the newspapers report it. Some people pick it up, and it eventually makes its way to the World Health Organization in Geneva. So reporting is a big issue, which you have to deal with physicians and hospitals and the like. And then secondly, the fact that the Biological Weapons Convention has about 170 member states now. It's about 20 less than the Chemical Weapons Convention. But there's no reporting under the Biological Weapons Convention. There's no administration of it. Whereas the Chemical Weapons Convention has 500 people administering it, of which 125 or so are inspectors in The Hague. The Biological Weapons Convention has three people in Geneva, barely enough just to organize meetings there. So there's no budget, there are no people, there are no inspections, there's no verification regime. And you may know in 2002 or 2001, when they had one of the last 5-year review conferences, an international ad hoc committee recommended that they build a much stronger biological weapons convention with an inspection regime, you know, which would inspect pharmaceutical facilities, secure laboratories, what we call BSL 3 and 4 laboratories, doing research on communicable diseases, even like, you know, avian flu and things of that nature. And the United States opposed that. And, you know, when the United States, as they say, when the United States speaks at one of these events, everyone listens and that's it. And they said they opposed it because they thought it was impractical, you know, where we have 5,000 commercial chemical industries in the world to be inspected that could build, produce dual-use chemicals. We have 80,000 pharmaceutical companies in the world that would have to be inspected. So it was partly practical. I also think it was partly because the Americans are at the cutting edge of research in all these areas, and probably much of Western Europe as well. And they didn't want international inspectors coming in, partly for proprietary reasons, partly for security reasons as well.
The question regarding the nuclear and the chemical weapons.
Yeah, well, on nuclear, you know, the I just came from Amsterdam 2 weeks ago at the nuclear security summit that you probably saw some news on that Obama, you know, started in 2010. And one of the biggest challenges in the nuclear sphere is that we have radioactive material and fissile material, a lot of it weapons grade, high enriched uranium and plutonium, in, well, the weapons grade material in over 24 countries around the world, a lot of it insecure. And then we have radioactive material largely used for medical purposes, medical isotopes, in over 100 countries around the world, most of it completely insecure. And radioactive sources, the low-level sources, you know, could be used potentially for a radioactive bomb, a dirty, what we call a dirty bomb, and you know, a improvised terrorist radioactive device. And even though that probably wouldn't do too much damage per se, like a nuclear weapon, obviously, it would have enormous, you know, psychosocial damage. So if the 911 attack in New York had radioactive sources, medical isotopes in the explosion, and there was a measurable level of higher radiation in Wall Street in Manhattan, you'd probably find nobody would be living there today. The whole, you know, bottom half of Manhattan would be empty of human life because nobody would want to live where there's high levels of radioactivity. So we are very worried about the proliferation of fissile material, the insecurity of a lot of it. Most of it, most of the weapons grade, 85% of the weapons grade material, plutonium and high enriched uranium, is in military stockpiles. And that's, none of that has been addressed yet. So I think if we talk about nuclear weapons all the time and the need to reduce nuclear weapons, we also need to reduce fissile material. And the amount of radioactive waste we're dealing with is enormous at a variety of sites. One of the worst in Northwest, you know, United States, Hanford, Washington, D.C., which has got, I know, hundreds of thousands of gallons of high-level and low-level radioactive waste from weapons research and development. So, yeah, this is also a very long legacy we're dealing with that eventually will have to be cleaned up. The other thing I would mention is nuclear power. A lot of this, some of it comes from nuclear power, you know, spent fuel, nuclear fuel cycles reprocessing. And the one thing no one ever agreed with in 1950, 60, 70, when all the nuclear power plants were being built, was that when the plants run their lifetimes, you know, 30, 40 years of use, and then they shut down, I think the image in the public mind was the plant will be taken down, you know, the site will be cleaned up, and it'll be used for some other good purpose. But what no one realized then is no one knows what to do with the spent fuel from these nuclear power plants now. As you know this well in Germany, and France knows this too, and many other countries that have nuclear power. And so almost every nuclear power site today will remain a highly secure, dangerous site because the spent fuel will be stored right there at the site for, I think, centuries to come. And so that's one of the big prices we're paying, other than, you know, the catastrophes of Chernobyl and Fukushima. We're all going to be paying for that in the end, too, in one way or another. I'm a very strong, you know, non-believer in nuclear power, as you can probably hear. And I think it's one of the biggest mistakes that we as a society in general made when we started thinking that, you know, we'd have free power through atoms of peace back in the 1950s and 60s. A lot of people obviously disagree with this, but I'm very happy that Germany is going non-nuclear. I don't know if that'll, I hope that'll continue. And Switzerland is too. But you're still going to have to deal with your nuclear waste. And that will be a dangerous, you know, operation for decades and decades and centuries to come. And I worry all the time about the vulnerability of these sites to terrorist attack. You know, if I were a terrorist, I would have, one of
don't
the, you know, you can imagine what you could do at one of these sites.
I think we also have to come to an end, but I think that Tilbo had a question, and then we can, your question is the only one which is more or less now between us and the reception, and then your answer.
Yeah,
so
go,
I think,
please go ahead. Yeah, that's a very good question. I mean, there's loads of politics in all of this, and I could go on and on, you know, for days on all the difficulties and political fights we've been in. But I really believe, for the most part, with the exception of North Korea and maybe Israel and Egypt today, everyone has given up on chemical weapons as a national military weapon. Still could be used as a they're very good terror weapons. If you can deploy them properly, you know, different from what the Japanese group did, they could be a very deadly weapon. But as a national means of defense, I think almost everybody so far, the North Koreans we know have a very large stockpile, all aimed at South Korea. I would hope that, you know, they would eventually give that up. The South Koreans gave theirs up, you know, 5, 6, 7 years ago. The United States has no desire to go back. None of our NATO allies, Germany included, have any desire to go back and reinvent chemical warfare. It just isn't very effective, frankly. You know, just to be very frank about it, it's not a very good weapon, and it's very unpredictable. The wind blows the wrong way; you kill your own troops. Some of the agents remain for a long time, so you can't cross the battlefield. It's really only a terror weapon, as we found in Halabja and Iran, Iraq, and those places. So I think with the Syrian sudden, for good reason, you know, the Syrian sudden joining of the convention, it puts enormous pressure on Israel and Egypt right now. Egypt has used chemical weapons in the past. 1963 in the Yemen war, they fired chemical weapons against Yemen. But I have no reason to believe today they have a chemical stockpile. No reason to believe the Israelis have a stockpile either. And I've said to both those countries in a variety of venues, it's time you guys, you know, join the civilized world in this area. You don't want to be in the same paragraph with North Korea, you know, or South Sudan. I think we'll see Israel and Egypt come on board the treaty in the next 2 years. They may have to do it simultaneously because nobody wants to go first. But now Syria has gone first, you know. So I think, hey, half the threat that Israel sees, Syria, the Syrian chemical weapons stockpile is gone now. The other issue, of course, on Syria, though, is has Bashar al-Assad declared all his stockpile? And I think you'll see, watch closely in the next, as soon as the weapons are out of Syria, hopefully, as I say, the end of this month, maybe in a May, there will be major questions raised by a number of the Western powers, the Americans certainly, the British, maybe the Germans, about whether in fact everything's fully been declared. So there's going to be loads of interesting political issues. And under the agreement from September, the OPCW inspectors are required to go in when one of these challenges is made within 48 hours in Syria to inspect whatever facility or site, whatever is made. But I think Angola, too, will join. Myanmar will join. They've both been to The Hague. There's ongoing discussions there. But the tough ones, I think, in the end will be South Sudan, that we're not really too worried about. They don't have chemical weapons. I don't see them trying to obtain them. But North Korea will be the last remaining big chemical weapons stakeholder. And then you have to inspect chemical industry for the long run. So once all the stockpiles are destroyed in 10 years, the Americans will be probably the last to finish. I think you've just got to do very thorough chemical industry inspections all the time to make sure they never reemerge someplace as a national secret project. But yeah, I really believe people have come to believe now we don't use these type of weapons anymore. Of course, more people are getting killed in Syria all the time without chemical weapons now. So it doesn't mean the killing stops. It just means the use of indiscriminate, you know, inhumane chemicals are not used anymore.
Paul, thank you very much for also showing it the light of the end of the tunnel. I think that's important. But I think also that it gave us many thoughts to think about in the next days. I think it was a very impressive talk.
Thank you.
I at least learned a lot about chemical weapons. Thank you very much for coming here.
Okay. Thank you.
And I'd like to invite